Hey guys, today I'm going to talk about the top 5 cards that I'm going to hold and I will buy into after rotation. So in case you don't remember, rotation is coming soon and we are not just rotating 1, 2, 3, we're rotating 4. 4 different sets, starting with Kaladesh, ending with Hour of Devastation, and including Amarket. And there's one in the middle that is slipping my mind right now, but that one too. So rotation is coming soon, and I thought I would make a video on some cards that will probably be at the low point now. And I'm actually ranking them from 1 to 5. So instead of doing, top 5 countdown and kind of hiding number 1, I just want to be very upfront with number 1, and I do love her. She's made me a lot of money already, as you can probably see from a previous video, but she is modern playable. So Healy combo is a fringe modern deck. It's almost like eggs in terms of the number of people who are playing it and just unique, how unique the deck is. So a lot of the Saheeli cards are isolated to Saheeli. You're trying to pull off this combo, which is Splinter Twin, but much, much slower and weaker and less easy to defend against. But people love Splinter Twin and they love combo decks. And this, in my opinion, is, if something is printed, this card goes to $10, $15 very easily in Modern. And Modern is a very good format. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about EDH. This card is not Modern playable in any aspect, but we had the -1/-1 counters be a big deal from Harbinger of the Night, which, as many of you have seen, I own many copies of. This could be the Harbinger of the Night many years from now. It is very powerful. It puts a lot of tokens. I mean, that's a ton of tokens that you're putting on different stuff. And if we have cards that activate, and we already have them, but it needs something else. So the premise I'm making is it's very easy to break this card in EDH with a future card. Right now, when you put +1/+1 counters, it's not like you get good benefits, but not any back-breaking benefits, right? Doubling the counters is always good, etc. I do like the Kaladesh Inventions at $32. Everything else has spiked. Minus the Gearhulk. For the majority, Torrential Gearhulk is obviously slightly more expensive than the rest as a masterpiece, but the rest of the Gearhulk are just kind of meh, and that is interesting. So I like the card itself, but I like the masterpiece far more than a regular card. I think it just takes a little time for something like this to become very good in EDH's Harbinger of the Night. It's an exact comparison. Like when I look at cards, because I've been playing the game for so long, I can be like, reminds me of this card. Fatal Push, I know a lot of you are saying, why Fatal Push? Everyone knows this is good. I think it's fantastic, and I think you want to get foil copies of the original. So it's not the regular Fatal Push I'm interested in, although that is interesting, and it makes Aether Revolt worth perhaps buying into. It's the actual... Aether Revolt was a set I missed when I was rotating. Aether Revolt, Kaladesh, Amarket, and Hour of Devastation. Something like this, which you know it's going to see play in Modern, you know it's going to see play in Legacy, you always want to get the foil copy, the foil original. I know there's a promo copy, but I'm not interested in it at all. You just look at the decks it is in. This is going to be the cheapest time you can buy a foil copy of this until it's reprinted for a long time. And I don't really see this being reprinted. I mean, of course they can reprint anything, right? Like that's a given. It's just a unique card, and you know, reprinting it in a master set, maybe I could see that, but not in another standard set because it is very, very powerful. It is the premier removal. Now, I like it. I do not like the FNM promos. I personally think the FNM promos do not look good. I would much rather pay the premium, and I know it is a premium, to get the foil copies, the original. All right, Anointed. This one in foil, I don't know why the multiplier is so low. It should be a 3x or 4x multiplier. What I'm saying is the foil price is not priced correctly. As of this recording on the video, I'm making the video Friday night, like almost Saturday morning, and I'm going to upload this video. And for you guys, I am going to try my best to be an MTG finance channel, because, you know, I'm driven by, hey, there's this other channel that's come, an up and coming channel. No, I'm going to do, I'll make a video on Rudy. A lot of you asked, like, you know, is he MTG finance? I think he's something else, because to do what Rudy does, you need massive capital, and the majority of Magic players don't have access to that capital. So you can't just buy out XYZ cards, right? You have to choose and pick, and that's very difficult to do. So here we have, I mean, I like it. A lot of times when I want to know if I'm going to go into a card like Anointed, I look at a card similar, like Parallel Lives, and I say, oh, that card went up to $10. Oh, that foil was like $30, $40. Yeah, this foil is going to be good. So do I like the regular copy? No, I like the foil copy. I think the regular copy will still be a $10 card eventually, but the regular copy is very good. Now, let me hedge everything by saying, and I have to make this hedge, everything can be reprinted. And it would be super easy for me to sit here and pick every reserve list card and then just make a whole list of 100 reserve list cards. Go buy them now. And that would be super easy. But there are dangers in speccing on these particular cards because they can be reprinted. Sacred Cat, the foil, I love it. I'm really into this popper thing. I didn't really believe it was real until like recently. As you probably saw from my trade binders. And the reason I'm making these trade binders is to show you it's hit and miss, right? Like, it's not always, oh, MTG Lion got everything right all the time. Yeah, I could make it seem that way, but what would be the point? It would be a disservice to you. And I think what I want to do is I want to tell you cards that I personally am buying and the strategy behind it. So Sacred Cat obviously is popper. The foil is interesting because just like, I don't think the foil actually looks that good and it is damaged many times. But when you talk about something printed this recently, there's just too many copies of it. There's too many non-foil copies to be interested. I think it's a very good popper card. I do love it in popper, but it's just too many copies. Like, it's like a bazillion copies. So you have to somehow limit it. And that would be the foil. So the foil copy of it is the same price of most of, like, Elves of the Deep Shadows and these other foil. It's $4 or $5, and that's what people would pay for it. Okay, so I'm going on a limb on this one because this is number 5. Remember, number 1 was Saheeli. How certain am I that Saheeli will be good eventually and be over $10? I am very certain. I am very certain that given her unique ability, I look at it and I say to myself, that's very powerful. That's a very powerful ability, and that's very unique, and it can double. And, like, there's something that, like, I know about her, and I know that there will be a card in the future that breaks her, and that 2-card combo will be Splinter Twin, some-esque. It'll be much better than what we currently have in Modern. Crested Sunmare, the reason I like it is it's one of those unique cards. Like, one of the tribes that I never thought would be worth any money was Minotaurs. Many of you don't know this, but Herlon Minotaur was the logo of Magic the Gathering. That Minotaur was the face of Magic the Gathering. I'm not kidding you. That was the Jace of Magic the Gathering. And everyone accepted it, but no one wanted to buy the card, but it was always like, oh, cool, Minotaurs. Now every Minotaur card is worth money because one day they printed a bunch of Minotaurs in one set, and then there were some more Minotaurs, and now there's a running, like, Minotaur every single set. Horses. My gosh, I could see that happening. The same with cats, right? How did cats become a deck for commander deck? Well, you printed a bunch of cats here, a bunch of cats there. So I think the archetype of horses is very interesting. You might think it's ridiculous for me to say that, but I saw cats, like panther warriors, right? Like, you know, I was making cat tribal when we had like five cats to choose from. Miri, cat warrior. And I was like, yeah, cat tribal. This is what casual players like. They like horses, cats, and minotaurs. Anyway, that's it. Bye, guys.